weekly worship service at First Baptist Church, Middlesboro, Kentucky. Join us on this journey of faith as we join our hearts and voices as one to celebrate God's faithfulness, grace, and love.
Good morning. Welcome to First Baptist. We're glad to see everyone this morning on Men's Day. If you would, please turn with me to the, if you have a bulletin, please turn to the back of it and look at the ministry opportunities for the following, for the coming week. We'd especially like to draw your attention this evening to the two sessions, the two study sessions that are going on. One of them begins at 5:30, Experiencing God in room 100. And the other session, The Mind of Christ, begins at 6 o'clock. And then adult handbell rehearsal is at 7. On Tuesday, the 25th, we have three circle meetings actually going on this week. The New Adventurers Circle meeting is going to be held at the Bookery down on Cumberland Avenue at 7 o'clock this Tuesday evening. And then the other two circles will meet Thursday, the 27th, the Emmanuel Circle at 1:30 p.m. and the Koinonia Circle will be also meeting at the Bookery at 7 p.m. Thursday evening. And on Wednesday evening at 6:30 p.m., Team Kids. And then remember that next Sunday, we have a special guest from the Oneida Baptist, it's Dr. Bill Underwood, and the Baptist Choir is going to be here. So we all want to be sure and try to attend to hear that next Sunday morning at 11 o'clock. Also, beginning in March, whether you are involved in Sunday school regularly or whether you're not, we want to encourage you to attend during the month of March. We have a special emphasis going on each week. The first week, we're just asking you simply to attend Sunday school, make an extra special effort to get to your class that you belong in. If you're not sure where that is, you can ask me or you can ask Charles Jones or any other Sunday school worker, and we'll be able to tell you where you should go. Also, the second week of March, we're asking you to invite someone from your class to come with you that doesn't maybe attend every week. The third week, we're asking you to invite a prospect to your Sunday school class. And then the fourth week of March is going to be High Attendance Sunday, where we want you, brothers, sisters, aunts, uncles, everyone that you can get to please come to Sunday school with you that week. So at this time, I think Jack has some information for us about the 30-hour famine.
I just wanted to take this opportunity to recognize the youth for a fantastic job on the 30-hour famine. For those of you who don't know, Friday and Saturday, a major portion of the youth group, we had 17 to 18 of the youth take part in the 30-hour famine. They went without food for 30 hours, and they did that in order to raise money for children around the world and here in the United States who are starving and who die every day from hunger-related diseases. And they were on TV and in the paper and everywhere. And they raised somewhere in the ballpark, we don't have the exact figures yet, of $4,000. And we've been working to get into their mind the statistic that 50 cents a day can feed a hungry child. And so that means that our youth have fed 8,000 hungry children. And I just think we need to congratulate them for that. And let's take this time to greet one another on this gorgeous Sunday morning.
Let us pray. Our Father, we thank you this day, for this glorious day, for this Men's Day celebration. We thank you for the gift of Christ Jesus, who came and died for our salvation. We pray that we would take his message to our community through the coming week. Please be with us now as we pray the prayer that you taught us, saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will.
We honor the men today, but it's still the Lord's Day. This is the Lord's Day, but we honor the men. This choir back here is traditional. The last time they sang, they were voted the most. Pay attention.
Privilege this morning to introduce our guest speaker for the day. And first of all, let me say that it's just been a wonderful Men's Day so far. I want to thank Drexel Morgan and Bob Barton and all their work with the Brotherhood and having a wonderful breakfast and time of fellowship. We had 85 men this morning for breakfast, so we were very excited about that and had a wonderful fellowship. And as we continue in worship this morning, we're just glad to have this special day in our church. This morning, we are honored to have Dr. Floyd Price to be our speaker for Men's Day. Dr. Price is the pastor of the Scottsville Baptist Church. That is in Allen County, about 45 minutes or so south of Bowling Green, if you don't know exactly
where Scottsville is. We have to explain where Middlesboro is, so we're used to, you know, it's an hour from, and so Bowling Green. But Dr. Price is a graduate of Cumberland College and Southern Seminary, and this past fall was elected as the president of the Kentucky Baptist Convention for 1997, and we're very proud to and honored to have him as our guest speaker today. His wife Reba is with us. Reba, stand up so they can see you. Floyd said you would, so Reba is from Middlesboro. She was Reba Jackson. Some of you may have known her when she was younger, and Floyd came across the mountain from Cumberland College and took her away. And so he was telling us a little bit about that this morning. I'm very glad to have Floyd on a personal basis. When I was 5 years old, we lived in Louisville, Kentucky, and we attended a little mission church of First Baptist Church Middletown. It was Woodland Hills Baptist Church, and Dr. Peter A. Jones was our pastor, and Floyd Price was our youth minister while he was a student at Southern Seminary. And Floyd and Reba would come to our house, and we would eat, and Floyd would go out in the backyard and throw football to me and throw baseball to me and take me to ball games. And so we've known each other for many years, and it's just an honor to have him now during his year of presidency, the Kentucky Baptist Convention. Floyd's going to come and bring greetings to you from the convention, and then later on he will bring our message. Floyd?
It is a special privilege to be here in Middlesboro and to be with Jeff, to be friends with a child and remain friends with him after he has grown, and pastoring a church is a special treat in my life. And you wouldn't think somebody as young as I am could have that kind of good experience, but it is good that you could do this at such a youthful age. And it is a treat and a blessing. Jeff's mom and dad were good friends of ours in those seminary years and thoughts here this morning, and I'm so glad for that. The Roberts and the Prices even bowled on a team together and won a trophy. It was called We Tried. It is a delight to be president of the Kentucky Baptist Convention, if for no other reason but to get the opportunity just to greet and meet Kentucky Baptists everywhere. And I thank you all for the privilege and opportunity of participating in God's work in this state, and for the opportunity to represent the many churches in our state. Let me share with you, while I greet you from the Kentucky Baptist Convention, a couple of things that, and I'm not going to bore you with the convention type reports. Just want to say a few things to you about what we're doing and some things that are important that you're doing and we are all doing together. Your participation in the mission and ministry of this state is vital. We're doing some old things and we're doing some new things. We're doing some old things in some new ways. We are still doing a partnership with Russia. In fact, Reba and I are going back to Russia for a second trip this June. We will do Bible schools and Bible classes and preach and do that kind of thing in a little town called, a little town, Ivanova, which is 500,000 people. But it's a little town in Russia. And we'll be going back to do that. There are still places on that team and other teams. If any of you would like to go and be a missionary for a couple of weeks, there's room for you, and you can just contact the Kentucky Baptist Convention. They need more people to go. We need to go, and Russia needs us desperately. We're doing new things in the Kentucky Baptist Missions Department. We had last year divided our mission work into what we call town and country. A lot of urban needs that we're trying to meet as Baptists, and then a lot of rural needs. They may be the same needs, but approached in different ways. And we've divided the Kentucky Baptist Missions Department into town and country. And just this last executive board or last administrative committee meeting, we have added another dimension to that and added the mountains to that, and have employed David Akers, who was a director of missions in Somerset, to coordinate the ministry and missions of Kentucky in the mountain regions of this state. And David is just a dynamite man, and he will do a good job for us in that. And we're looking forward to that. It's kind of an old thing we did years ago that's been revitalized, and David is going to lead us in that work. We're still looking for an executive secretary for this state. We have a large committee that quietly is working. You pray for them. I can't give you any report on what they're doing. They're pretty well quiet and private, but they're a wonderful group of people. Pray for them as they seek a leader for us. Our Southern Baptist work is being reorganized. You may have been reading some of that. Our foreign mission work continues on, and you participate in that through your cooperative program gifts. We are in the process in Southern Baptist Convention of seeing a reorganization of what was the Home Mission Board, and it will be called the North America Mission Board. And there, I hear them throwing the word NAM around all the time. So you can get used to, instead of the Home Mission Board, you can get used to hearing people talk about NAM, the North American Mission Board. And there are some reorganizational changes in the Southern Baptist Convention to reduce the top office people and increase the number of people who are serving. And there is some great, great work being done by the Cooperative Baptist Fellowship also. And they are doing, Cooperative Baptist came on the scene and began to do mission work that Southern Baptist Convention normally in the old four mission board structure never tried to do before. Mission work, for example, to gypsies in Europe. And that they are people who don't live anywhere. And they are the roaming people of our world. And this mission group is reaching out to do them. So we are doing a lot of kinds of missions together. And let me encourage you to continue to pray for all the mission work that we are involved in, you're involved in, through your prayers, through your giving, through your study, through your church. And pray for those who serve together with us in many places and in many ways, not only in Kentucky, but in this entire world. I'm proud to be involved in all of these things as a Kentucky Baptist, and I pray that you are with me. We hold hands together to tell our world about the love of Jesus Christ, and continue being the church that you are.
This morning, as we continue our movement toward the cross, we join together with our Lenten prayer of confession. Each Sunday morning as we head toward the cross, we extinguish a candle to remind us that it was our sins that extinguished the life of our Lord Jesus Christ. Read with me our Lenten prayer of confession this morning. Most loving and patient God, we confess we have sinned against you and against one another. You created us in freedom in order to show your great love toward us, but we have abused that freedom. We have not shown love to you in return. You fashioned us in your perfect image in order that we might love one another, but we have distorted that image. We have not loved others as Christ loved us. Loving too much, we make idols of those things you gave us to show your love. Loving too little, we neglect and hurt the very ones you entrusted to us. God, have mercy. For we have put out the light of your gospel. Christ, have mercy, for we have put out your light. God, have mercy. Although it was our sin that crucified our Lord Jesus Christ, Paul gives us that gospel word of hope that while we were yet sinners, Christ died for us.
Now let us continue our worship by standing and singing Jesus Paid It All, number 134.
Thank you for the opportunity to be in your house today. This prayer of gratitude goes for this place of worship, the opportunity to be here in this town. And as we give our offerings, we thank those that have it to give and those that do not, and that it go for the glory of your worship and here in Middlesboro. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Today's scripture reading is Matthew chapter 4, verses 18 through 22. As Jesus was walking beside the Sea of Galilee, he saw two brothers, Simon called Peter and his brother Andrew. They were casting a net into the lake, for they were fishermen. "Come follow me," Jesus said, "and I will make you fishers of men." At once they left their nets and followed him. Going on from there, he saw two other brothers, James of Zebedee and his brother John. They were in a boat with their father Zebedee, preparing their nets. Jesus called them, and immediately they left the boat and their father and followed him.
He stood and applauded us, so we knew from the start this road would not lead to fame. All we really knew for sure was Jesus had called to us. He said, "Come follow me," and we came with reckless abandon. We came.
Empty nets lying there at the water's edge told a story that few could believe and none could explain. How some crazy fishermen agreed to go where Jesus led, with no thought for what they would gain. For Jesus had called us by name,
and we answered, "We will abandon it all for the sake of the call. No other reason at all but the sake of the call.
Drawn like the rivers are drawn to the sea, there's no turning back, for the water cannot help but flow. Once we hear the Savior's call, we'll follow wherever he leads, because of the love he has shown, because he has called us to go.
We will answer, we will abandon it all for the sake of the call. No other reason at all but the sake of the call. Holy, devoted to live and to die, not for the sake of a creed or a cause, not for a dream or promise, simply because it is Jesus who calls, and if we believe, we'll obey. We will abandon it all for the sake of the call.
No other reason at all
but the sake of the call.
This morning we have to do things just a little different because this is Men's Day. Men's Day. Yeah, guys. And I thought we would do it different this morning. Now, how about that? Watch out there, Tyler, it's coming to you. I like to fish. Some of you all probably do too. I have been some successful with fishing. I have enjoyed it. Yeah, see there? That was a bass right there. He just didn't bite. And I could. I won't. No. Fishing is a lot of fun. Men particularly like to fish. And I have found fishing to be very exciting thing and a very relaxing thing, but a very useful thing. When you take somebody who isn't a Christian and put them in a boat and row out to shore, out from the shore, I found that they have to listen to you. They can't get up and walk away. There is a strange thing that I found, that's a reluctance on the part of some people to get in the boat with a preacher. And I think that's why, you know. I want to talk to you about fishing today. Fishing with Jesus. He did that, you know. It says so right here in the 5th chapter of Matthew. One day, as Jesus was standing by the lake of Gennesaret, with the people crowding around him and listening to the word of God, he saw at the water's edge two boats left there by the fishermen. His mouth was watering to go fishing. They were washing their nets. He got into one of the boats belonging to Simon and asked him to put out a little from the shore. Then he sat down and taught the people from the boat. When he'd finished speaking, he said to Simon, "Put out into the deep water and let down your nets for a catch." This guy I like to fish with. Automatic fish finder. Simon answered, "Master, we've worked hard all night and haven't caught anything. But because you say, I will let down the nets." When they had done so, their nets became... The catch of fish was such a large number that their nets began to break. So they signaled to their partners in the other boat to come and help them, and they came and filled both boats so full they began to sink. This is getting better all the time. When Simon saw this, he fell at Jesus' feet and said, "Go away from me, Lord. I am a sinful man." For he and all his companions were astonished at the catch of fish they had taken. And so were James and John, the sons of Zebedee, Simon's partners, who were probably the best fishermen in the Bible. Peter finds with his friends that they had fished all night and the wind was out of the east or something was going on. The water wasn't murky enough. But they had fished all night. Didn't catch anything. They pulled their boats up on the beach, washed the nets out. That was to keep the nets neat and clean. My boats never were that way. They put up their tackle. Jesus then came along and he borrowed one of their boats for a pulpit. You know, when you're fishing with Jesus, you're not real sure what you're catching. He finished teaching the people on the shore. Then he turned to the disciples who were in the boat and he said, "Take this thing out in the deep water and drop your nets." Now, Simon Peter and these guys are not amateurs by any stretch of the imagination. They fished all night and they hadn't caught anything. And Jesus is telling them, "Go out and drop your nets." You've had those days when nothing was being caught yourself, haven't you? Not a good day. But they said, nevertheless, this is not a good fishing day. But nevertheless, if you say so, we're going to fish with you. You know, there are some people that you fish with, and some people you're just with and you fish. Is that right? This is men's day. They know what I'm talking about. They decided to fish with Jesus, and they did what he said. Now, from this story, I want to give you four things about fishing with Jesus that you need to hear. And whether you're one of our men or a woman or a teenager, listen to me. Some things we can learn from Jesus' fishing experiences. First of all, fishing with Jesus can be a routine experience. Listen to what I have to say about that. It's important. Jesus came to meet these men where they were. They were fishermen, and Jesus came to where fishermen were, and he fished. Then it is at this point that the uncommonly holy Jesus met with the commonly unholy men of the world in the ordinary things that they were doing. And that's our Jesus. It is not in the spectacular things that are wonderfully sparkling religious that God always speaks to us. A group of men from Winchester, Kentucky asked me to go fishing with them. And my brother was their pastor, but I was also a pastor. And they called me what they call all pastors in most all churches, preacher. We only do that 30 or 40 minutes a day on Sunday and Sunday night, but the rest of the time we're just preacher, you know. But because I was preacher, they invited me to go over here to Newport, Tennessee and fish. I guess that's Douglas. And the first day out, why, they all looked at each other and looked at me, and one of them said, "Come on, preacher." And I got in the boat with him and I fished hard all day. I caught as much as they did, which wasn't very much, but I did as well as they did. It's like playing golf with a bad golfer. You know, you might be bad, but so is everybody else. About noon, this guy looks across the boat at me and he said, "Preacher, you fish hard." And I said, "Did you think because I was a preacher that I didn't know anything about fishing?" And he said, "Well, yeah, that's kind of what I thought." I want to say to you that Jesus gets locked out of our lives because we think Jesus can't fish. We put it on a woman's plane. We let Jesus get locked out of our lives because we think Jesus doesn't know anything about sowing. But my Lord came to men wherever they were and addressed their lives like they were in the routine and what we would call the unholy, but there he was. Jesus Christ comes to your life wherever you are. If you're going to fish with Jesus, it will be a routine, ordinary thing. Stop trying to think that we divide things into two sections. There is the religious over here, where we have religious. And then there is the work over here where we work. This is more likely where Jesus is going to be. Over there where the religious are. He tried that once. You got me? If you're going to fish with Jesus, it's going to be where the ordinary things are. Secondly, I want you to see that fishing with Jesus brings a renewal. Why are people sad and down and having problems? One, because they don't fish. Well, that's true. Two-thirds of the world is water, isn't it? God made us to fish. But the real reason is they don't fish with Jesus, because that brings a renewal in our lives. Peter was no amateur. He knew how to fish. He'd been at it all night, and he knew things weren't right. It wasn't a deep water day. And Jesus said, go out and put your nets in the deep water. Peter's saying inside, I know, wind's out of the east. Deep water's not where they are. I've been trying it. But Jesus comes along and calls him to renew his thinking. I was fishing over here around Jellicoe one time with a fellow who taught me how to bass fish, and he was nice to me because I was a preacher. And he always let me fish from the front of the boat. The front of the boat goes by the places first, so you don't get hung up as much. It was really because he didn't want to get untangling me all the time. But I threw back in this place where there was a bass. There had to be a bass. Pretty place for a bass. A little cove underneath some hanging bushes. And threw my bait under there. Five times is the norm. If nothing hits in five times, just move on. They're probably not there. I threw in there five times. Nothing. We sleezed on by, and he threw up in there. I said, Robert, there's nothing there. I've been in there five times. It's empty. He said, okay. He threw up in there and snagged a five-pound bass that took us 30 minutes to get in. And all of a sudden, fishing got more interesting. When you fish with Jesus and let him into your life and let him be involved with what you are, there is a renewal that takes place. Sometimes we quit when it's just time to start. Sometimes when we know it all, Jesus knows more. Wasn't it good that Peter, though he was tired and discouraged and through for the day, had enough presence of mind to accept Jesus' invitation to fish and got a renewal experience with his life? What a catch. If you fish with Jesus, he'll bring a revival to you. We need to be open to change and open to listen and open to be different. Jesus wasn't exactly the same. I mean, after all, anybody that'll throw a net down into the deep water after real fishermen have fished all day is different. But Jesus Christ didn't put you on this earth and in this town and in this place to be just the same old, same old, same old. He put you here to be different because he directs your life. And he calls you to be a fisherman. He invites you to be involved with him. Jesus comes in the ordinary and the routine. Jesus brings revival when you'll fish with him. Third, sometimes we're reluctant to fish with Jesus, are we not? The disciples were reluctant. Peter listened as Jesus taught the crowds, but he wasn't sure he wanted to do much more. That proved Peter was pretty much Baptist. He liked to listen to what was going on, but he wasn't sure he wanted to do much more. He wasn't sure he wanted in the boat with this man, Jesus. Many of us are not sure we want to get in the boat with Jesus Christ. These boats took me fishing down in Tennessee. The second day we went out, we standing on the dock, and one of them said, who's taking the preacher? Well, I stood there. I wasn't taking me. And they all looked around at each other. One looked the other one. Did this number, you know, around. Finally, one of them said, I'll take him. Whew. At least I didn't have fish from the dock, you know. I'll take him. Who wants this guy in the boat? After all, when we open the cooler, he's going to see what's in there. And when we tell the stories, we have to change them. We don't want him in the boat. We don't want Jesus in the boat. Peter wasn't sure he wanted to. Peter wasn't the first one. Jonah didn't want to go with God, and he had a wild ride before he got to Nineveh. Moses was reluctant to do what God called him to do. Even when he encountered a holy God, he was reluctant. Paul was reluctant until he was struck by a blinding light. But once all of these overcame their reluctance to follow God, their lives were changed. Sometimes when we are in a bit of a doubt, we need to make a commitment of faith that shows we believe in our Lord and go with Him to see what God does with us. Now, if you're wondering how that'll come out, Peter tried that and filled up two boats. Imagine what he told down at the store. You see, when you fish with Jesus, it takes a lot of faith. It rearranges your whole life. It changes everything. I've got some 80-year-old ladies at church tomorrow or next Sunday that are worried about changing their life because they're having to choose between Jesus or Father Ricky. He plays on television at 11 in our town, and they can't decide who they're going to worship. One of them asked me last Sunday, he said, "Preacher, what are you going to do about UK playing basketball at 11 o'clock next Sunday?" And I said, "You'll get to see the second half." We can't decide sometimes whether we want to get in the boat with Jesus Christ. But let me tell you something. If you will make that kind of commitment and let Jesus Christ be your Lord and your Savior and follow Him committedly, you'll have a boat full. Fourth and finally, when you fish with Jesus, it's not only routine. It not only brings you renewal, and sometimes it not only brings reluctance to us, but fishing with Jesus will also redirect your whole life. Young people, I'm glad y'all are sitting on the front row. You know, it's dangerous. You could have gotten hit in the head by a sinker, and then you'd go to school tomorrow and say, "What happened to you?" "Well, I went to church." You don't want to hear the rest of it. If you'll fish with Jesus Christ, He'll give you direction. It may not be where you thought you'd go, but He'll redirect your whole life. And it's exciting and wonderful. I mean, after all, who thought 40 or 50 years later, after I was throwing football with a 5-year-old in the backyard in Louisville, Kentucky, that we would be on the same platform worshiping together like this? You know, God just does some neat things. And He always did. He always will. And if you'll let Him, if you'll fish with Him, He'll redirect your life. Listen, men, John Wesley said, "If I had 300 men who feared nothing but God, hated nothing but sin, and were determined to know nothing of the world but Jesus Christ, I would set the world on fire." 300 men. John Wesley was right. He was talking about being committed, the kind of commitment that changes where you go and what you do. This is the kind of commitment that we talk about and that we teach about, but seldom comes about. But if we'll learn to fish with Jesus, He will give you a kind of commitment that redirects life until you have a conscience you can live with, a creed you can live by, a cause you can live for, a goal you can live toward, a community you can live in. But you have to be committed to make those things happen. Peter was willing to let down his nets, and then the fish came. And then God called him to a greater venture than that. When the fish came, He said to Peter, "Y'all come with me, and I'll make you fishers of men. I'll do something greater with you than fill up these boats." There's an incredible amount of human need all around every one of us. There are so many who need to be loved and taught and helped. There's so much lostness and so much secular thinking and not enough sacred thinking in our world. But to reach these people with the good news of Jesus Christ, it'll take a lot of commitment from a lot of men and women who are willing to be fishers of men. And you can't fish with Jesus unless he renews and redirects all your life. What an adventure to be in the boat with him. Will you? Have you? If you're here this morning and you have never accepted Jesus Christ as your Lord and Savior, he invites you to come with him. Let him direct your life in a wonderful, adventuresome way. If you're here this morning and you've never accepted Christ as your Savior, this is a time to do that during this invitation. Come, say, I want to give my heart to him. If you're here this morning and you are a Christian, but you're not being a fisher of men, you're not where God has called you to be, stop being reluctant and get in the boat with him. Rededicate your life. Recommit your life to him. Maybe you're here this morning and your membership is some other church, but this is a good place for you to fish. God calls you to move your membership and do that. Participate with Jesus Christ. Fish with him. He calls you to do that. Let's pray together. Oh, Father, you have called us to be fishers of men. It takes a great deal of faith, oh Lord, to give ourselves completely to you. But, Father, you have shown us the rewards that are there. Help us to give ourselves to you and to be your servant. Let you be our master, that our boats might be full with joy and success. This is our prayer in Jesus' name. Amen. Your pastor, Brother Jeff, will come stand before you. We'll have our invitation hymn, which is found on page 307, Just As I Am Without One Plea. And as we offer this invitation, if the Holy Spirit leads you to make a commitment, we invite you to do that. Jeff, come.
Good morning. This is Jeff Roberts, pastor of the First Baptist Church of Middlesboro, Kentucky. I am so glad that you have chosen to worship with us today through our Sunday morning broadcast. We hope each week that you are blessed by God, encouraged in the faith, and challenged to live your life with a deeper commitment to and a relationship with God through God's Son, Jesus Christ. For nearly 20 years, our morning worship service has been broadcast as an outreach ministry to our city, and we are glad to provide this ministry to you. However, we at First Baptist do not believe that there is a substitute for being with God's people in God's house for worship. So if you are new in our city, or if you currently do not attend one of our other wonderful churches in the Middlesboro area, we invite you to worship with us in person next week. Our Sunday school begins at 9:45, and there you will find Bible study and fellowship for all ages. It is followed by our morning worship service at 11 a.m. First Baptist Church is located at 23rd and Cumberland in downtown Middlesboro. If we can minister to you, or if you would like more information concerning our many exciting ministries at First Baptist, feel free to write us or call us at our church office during our regular office hours. Until next week, it is our prayer that you might know the transforming love of God and the peace that comes through relationship with his Son, Jesus Christ.
Wonderful to be in God's house today. We thank Dr. Price for his message and his humor that has led us into worship this morning and encountering our God.
We're glad to have Roger Russell come this morning to join our church by transfer of a letter from the Southside Baptist Church here in Middlesboro. If you rejoice with Roger's decision, would you say welcome to First?
Welcome to First.
We're glad to have Roger. He's been coming and worshiping with us for some time. We're glad to have him come and join our church today. You want to come by and greet him and welcome him into our fellowship? I'm going to ask Reba if you'll join Floyd down front also, and they can greet you before they leave this morning. It's been good to be in God's house. We thank all those responsible for our Men's Day, and I appreciate all the hard work that's gone in to making this a very special time of worship. We will close by singing our closing chorus that you find on the back of your bulletin, "Rise Up, O Men of God."
Good morning. Okay, just because Jeff's gone doesn't mean you guys can fall asleep. Let's try that again. Good morning. All right. We would like to welcome all of our guests this morning, especially our brothers and sisters from Oneida who are visiting. I'd like to take this opportunity to share with you the many ministry opportunities that are going on this week and in weeks to come at our church. Pull out the blue insert. It's in your bulletin, or blue, purple, the purple insert that's in your bulletin, and take notice of the many things that are going on in the coming months. They're quite numerous, so I won't mention them all, but if you look at the back of your bulletin, I would like to mention a few things that are going on this evening and this afternoon at the church. I would like to remind the youth and those members of the youth ministry team that have said they will take part. We will be having a lunch afterwards, as well as the Oneida Choir and our visitors down in the fellowship hall directly after the worship service this morning. Also at 5 p.m. this afternoon, there is a children's ministry and preschool children's department Sunday school workers meeting in the fellowship hall as well. And at 6 p.m., We'll be starting for the adults a new Bible study called What Do Baptists Believe? And that's quite appropriate for a church such as ours that has people from so many varied backgrounds. And I would also like to remind you that this month is our Sunday School Emphasis Month. And this morning, hopefully you brought yourself to Sunday School. And next Sunday, concentrate on trying to bring someone with you who is enrolled in Sunday School, but not very active. And now let's change gears and focus ourselves on God and bring ourselves to the point where we can worship Him. Let's just leave all the baggage that we brought in from this past week and the things that we're worrying about in the week to come behind, and just open ourselves up and empty ourselves to God and allow Him to fill us. As we begin this process of worship, we will start that with our spoken call to worship found in the beginning of your bulletin. Beneath the cross of Jesus, beneath the cross of Jesus, able to stand free of condemnation, come, O Lord, and make us strong.
Will you join us as we stand together in lifting our voices in praise and singing that hymn, Beneath the Cross of Jesus, number 291. On this third Sunday in Lent, we continue through the process and the pilgrimage as we make our way to Holy Week, as we walk step by step along the last days of the life of Jesus, remembering the agony and the trials that He went through, and most of all, remembering the great love that He showed for us, even as He walked those last steps to the cross and to His death. as we see that great love unfold during these weeks of Lent. We become painfully aware of our own sinfulness and our inadequacies, and we are drawn to confession. So on this third Sunday in Lent, will you join me again as we read together in unison our Lenten prayer of confession. Most gracious and merciful God, we confess. We have sinned against you and against your children. We have taken for granted blessings of which we are not deserving, instead of showing humble gratitude through our words and deeds. We have shamefully abused your goodness to us for our own benefit and pleasure, instead of joyfully sharing your goodness for the benefit of others and for your pleasure. We have selfishly hoarded the perfect light of your love instead of reflecting that light into a world still groping into darkness. God, have mercy, for we have put out the light of your gospel. Christ, have mercy, for we have put out your light. God, have mercy. Hear again the gospel word of hope. While we still were sinners, Christ died for us. As you have already noticed, as they processed in and standing behind me, we have new choir robes. No, actually, we still have the choir robes we've been using. We have brought in new choir robes with new people to fill them this morning. We are so delighted to have the high school choir from the Oneida Baptist Institute. Their director is Tim Cochran, and they are accompanied by Joey Godbold, and they will be sharing with us in just a moment. And later in our worship this morning, we're also delighted and pleased to have Dr. Bud Underwood, the president of the Oneida Baptist Institute, and he will be coming in a few moments after the choir has sung and after we receive the offering this morning. He will come and share with us further about this great institution and the wonderful ministry that they are providing for this area. And so now I'm going to turn it over to Joy and to Tim, and we ask you to worship with them as they lead us in song and continuing in our worship this morning. Thank you.
Yeah.
Tim, Joy, thank you, and choir, excellent job. Thank you so much. You have blessed us, you have inspired us, and you have challenged us, and you have enriched our worship this morning. Our offertory hymn is a hymn of providence that reminds us that God stays with us at all times and watches over us. And it is also a prayer for God to continue to watch over us and to lead us. Savior, like a shepherd, lead us. Will you join me as we will sing the first and the last stanza only. The first and last stanza, hymn number 61, Savior, like a shepherd, lead us. Again, let's stand as we sing.
Please pray with me. Father, we have so many things to be thankful for. We are thankful that we can come here and give our hearts to you again this morning, to worship you and lift you on high and praise you through singing and through giving our tithes and our offerings. We pray, Father, that you would help us to experience worship this morning like never before, and that you would help us to experience your presence this week like never before, that we could go out and be the Christians that you have called us to be. And it's in your name that we pray. Amen. You may be seated.
Thank you.
Our scripture lesson for this morning is found in Matthew chapter 25, verses 35 through 40. And it's recorded there that Jesus said, "I was hungry, and you gave me something to eat. I was thirsty, and you gave me something to drink. I was a stranger, and you invited me in. I needed clothes, and you clothed me. I was sick, and you looked after me. I was in prison, and you came to visit me." Then the righteous will answer him, "Lord, when did we see you hungry and feed you, or thirsty and give you something to drink? When did we see you a stranger and invite you in, or needing clothes and clothe you? When did we see you sick or in prison and go to visit you?" And the king will reply, "I tell you the truth. Whatever you did for one of the least of these brothers of mine, you did for me."
It is indeed a great privilege to be here this morning. I want you to know that you've already had the best. You've had the choir. Jesus said, you know, when you go to a wedding feast, you always bring out the best wine first, and so that's what I've done. So the big guns have already gone off. But we are deeply honored to be here this morning. I have really felt good about being here. From the moment we pulled into the parking lot, there were folks waiting to greet us and show us where to park. And I guess that no less than 24 people have greeted us this morning, and I appreciate that. You go into a strange church and don't know where you're going, and all the people, many folks have said that they've been to our campus and have visited our school. You've just been very, very kind and gracious, and I appreciate that. I appreciate being allowed to come this morning and share with you, both for our choir, being allowed to perform for you this morning, and let me share just a little bit about Oneida and why your bulletin says it's a special place and things that are unique about Oneida. And I want to compliment these young people. We're in a different church every Sunday, and usually or oftentimes two services, and I don't think that I've seen young people sit in the front of the church all this year or last year. You are to be commended, young people. You sit in the front of the church. And I don't know if that's because the older folks ran you out of the back and there are no more pews back there. But at any rate, oftentimes the young people will sit in the very back of the church, or they sit up in the balcony, and they could care less about what's going on in the service. And so I just really appreciate you young people being up here in front. It is, again, as I said, a pleasure to be with you this morning. I want to share with you just a few moments the things that I think are special and unique about Oneida. I think that every ministry that Kentucky Baptists support, every ministry that this church may support, any ministry everywhere, has an obligation, I believe, to make sure they're doing things that are unique and special. Make sure they're doing something that is meeting the needs of people, young and old, here in Kentucky, across the United States, and around the world. And there are some things about Oneida that are definitely unique. Oneida, many, many years ago, as we're in our 98th academic year, there are some things that were set in motion many, many years ago that I believe have helped carry Oneida through all these many years, through two world wars, through a Great Depression, through many recessions and many other wars, the Vietnam War, the Korean War. I think there are some reasons we can look back to see why God has chosen to bless Oneida. I think we can look back and see why there are a lot of Kentucky Baptists and other people who have found a soft spot in their heart for Oneida and what we're doing there. We have taken and have for many, many, many years a different approach to Christian ministry. We are different in many ways. I do not intend or mean to put down those other ministries. Their ministries are unique within themselves, but we do things quite a bit differently. One area that we are different from most Christian schools is that we take boys and girls who are lost. If I understand what Jesus meant in Mark 2:17, it was Jesus who said that people who are healthy do not need a physician, but rather those who are ill. What greater opportunity will you ever have to win a lost boy or girl to Jesus than in a Christian school? We know that not every young person who comes to Oneida will become a Christian. And I would be amiss if I told you that wasn't really our goal, but we know realistically that that's not going to happen. It was Jesus again who said in Luke the 8th chapter that our responsibility as Christians in this community and throughout the state of Kentucky, throughout the world, and even over in Clay County at Oneida, our responsibility is to be sowers of the seed. And I never appreciated until I became the president the rest of that parable. I've always understood what it meant to be a sower of the seed, but I've never appreciated the fact that Jesus said, "Beware, be on guard, I'm telling you, I'm giving you advance warning, not all of your seed will fall on good soil. No matter how intense we are, no matter how sincere we are about seeing our friends and neighbors and people in our community one to the Lord, Jesus said that our obligation is to sow the seed, but again warns us that not all of that seed is going to fall on good soil. Not everyone who came in contact with Jesus became a believer. There were those who came in contact with Jesus and then chose to go their own separate ways. In John 6:66, it tells us, "And many of his disciples departed from him, never to serve him again, because they did not appreciate and understand all that Christ was saying." And so I wish that I could report to you that all the young boys and girls who come to Oneida eventually become Christians, but that is not true. It is true that we do not always get to see the fruits of our labors. It is true that oftentimes young people call or write or come back to see us years later and say, "It was the things I learned at Oneida. Those days I sat in daily chapel and didn't really care about what was being said, and I wish we didn't even have chapel. It was those preaching services in that Sunday school class that I sat in that I could have cared less. But those things have stuck with me. And years later, when I began to go out into the quote-unquote real world, I began to let those words sink into my heart and began to realize how much Christ could make a difference in my heart. I am happy to report that every year, normally, between 100 and 125 boys and girls do make professions of faith in our campus, and we are grateful for that. There's a second area where Oneida is unique among Christian schools, and that is we have not been afraid to take that boy or girl who may have a special need. I know among Kentucky Baptists there are a lot of people that when they hear the word Oneida and not Oneida, I know you're kind of in between Oneida and Oneida. It's Oneida everywhere else, but it's Oneida, Kentucky. And folks around Oneida call it Oneidy. But at any rate, one of the unique things about Oneida has been the fact that we have chosen to reach out to boys and girls who are hurting, who have needs. Again, going back to the scriptures and going back to a parable that Jesus tells, and that one that you know as well as I do, in Luke the 10th chapter, Jesus said there was a man traveling one day to Jericho. Now you know what happened. As he was traveling on that road, some thieves and robbers jumped out from behind a tree, a rock, a bush, or something, and they beat this man up. Jesus said they left the man laying there along the roadside in pretty pitiful condition. Jesus said he was half dead. That's pretty serious. But you know, as a lay person, for I'm not a pastor, I'm a lay person like most of you. I read the scriptures through the eyes of a lay person, and I have the mind of comprehension of a lay person. But I have read that parable, and I've reread that parable, and I cannot find anything this man did wrong. And yet there he was along the roadside of life, half dead. Now Jesus, as he tells this story, talks about the religious community, the priest and the Levite. They came along, one after the other, and Jesus said they looked upon him, they saw his need, and for various reasons chose to walk on the other side of the road. A real warning to those of us who have opportunities to minister. For when you have done unto the least of one of these, my brethren, you have done it unto me. And that priest and Levi missed the opportunity that day to minister to someone that was well within their ability to minister to. Well, you know what happened? The Samaritan came along. He's referred to as the Good Samaritan. I heard a message not long ago calling him the Great Samaritan. And probably we all refer to him as the Great Samaritan because he did something unique. Jesus said, "Here comes this Samaritan." And when he looked upon the man, he had compassion for him. He didn't stand along the roadside and condemn him or criticize him or try to do an analysis as to how you got in this condition. What this Samaritan did was he saw a fellow human being who was hurting, and he chose to help him. I want to tell you something, that when you choose to help people in need, you run, first of all, some risks. You run some risks. Has it ever occurred to you that as that Samaritan knelt down there along that gutter, along that roadside there, and began to minister to that man, did it ever occur to you that he must have been wondering, "I wonder where the men are that did this? Are they there hiding in the bushes, behind the trees, behind a rock? Are they going to do the same thing to me that they did to this man?" There are risks. Anytime you reach out in your community, anytime you reach out to your relatives and loved ones and try to help, there are some risks. Sometimes the risk is simple rejection, which can be the most painful of all rejections. When you have done all you can do to reach out to people and to share the love of Jesus with them, you're not doing it because you're particularly a compassionate person, because Jesus instructs us to have that kind of compassion. And yet, in spite of all that you can do, in spite of all the love, all the compassion you try to show, that person rejects all that you do. That is a risk you have to run. And of course, we don't need to run that risk every day, because not every young person accepts what we try to share with them. A second thing that you have to understand this about the Samaritan was he was willing to interrupt his journey. How often do you and I, as we travel down life's highway, miss opportunities to minister and to witness because we're in a hurry, we're not willing to interrupt our journey? And yet, if we're going to meet people's needs when they have those needs, oftentimes they're not in our daily schedule, they're not on our calendar. We have not planned to interrupt our journey to meet this need. But when those opportunities arise, we have the option of doing what the priest and Levi did, and that was to walk on the other side of the road, or we can interrupt our journey, realizing that person's needs probably far outweighs anything that you or I have to do or any business that we have to conduct. A third thing about helping people to have needs, it's going to cost you something. It's going to cost you something. I don't know that when this Samaritan knelt down to help this man that he began to calculate all these things, but in the back of his mind, he probably suspected there's going to be a cost here. You know, this, Jesus tells a story that he poured wine and oil on his wounds and put bandages on his wounds. And then Jesus said he put the man on his burro, his donkey, and took him to the next community where there was an inn. And Jesus said that he, the Samaritan, cared for him that night. He cared for him that night. And then the next morning did something that most of us would probably do. Jesus said the next morning the Samaritan went down to the innkeeper, reached in his pocket, and pulled out 2 denarii. That was about 2 days' wages. I can see you or I doing that. I can see us as we would have enough compassion to maybe dip into our reserves to the equivalent of 2 days' wages and lay them out there on the counter telling the innkeeper, here, this should cover all the costs, all the expenses we incurred while we've stayed here. But then he did something that not many would do. He, in effect, took a check out. He wrote the name of the inn. He gave the blank check to the innkeeper and said this: I am going to continue my journey. I have someplace I have to be. I'm going to continue my journey, and I will return in a few days. And when I return, you fill in the amount of additional expenses, and I will endorse the check. That's really what he said. That takes a lot of love for a total stranger. It takes a lot of love sometimes for us at Oneida as we reach deep into our financial pockets to help a boy or girl who does not necessarily appreciate it. Sometimes we take a young person on a full scholarship. About 1/3 of our students come to us paying either nothing or almost nothing. 1/3. That's almost historic among other Christian schools. If you ask most Christian schools how many scholarships you provide, and if they give as many as 20 or 25 for every 500 or 600 kids, that's a high number. But 1/3 of our nearly 500 students are on full or nearly full scholarship, and nearly full means they're paying $1 or $2 a day. But when we take those young people, we count the cost, and we know that we're going to have to provide their room and their board and their education for them free of charge up front. But then oftentimes we find a month or two down the road, the young person needs shoes. The young person needs some hygiene items. The young person needs some trousers. The young person needs other things. And we cannot say, well, now, wait a minute, we didn't agree to do that. We didn't agree to provide clothing and other material needs. We agreed to provide their room and their board and their tuition. But we find ourselves all the time reaching deep in our pockets and providing many other things that we never expected to have to provide. And so simply I want to say to you that Oneida, for all of these many years, has chosen not to walk on the other side of the road for a young person who is hurting, a young person whose only sin in life may be that they're growing up in a single-parent family, a young person who has need and their only sin in life is that they're a poor child,
Their only sin is they're growing up in the inner city and have not had opportunities other boys and girls have had. A lot of young people come to Oneida. Yes, they have needs, but they are as innocent and are as much a victim as that man laying along the roadside on the road to Jericho. A third thing that makes Oneida unique, and I'm not going to dwell on this because I'm running out of time, and that is we have not refused to take an older student. It's a small part of our ministry. As I look at your purple insert here, your blue insert, and I see all these activities. I'm sorry, the other one here, I saw a lot of activities, the back of your bulletin, I'm sorry. I see all those activities. You're a very busy church, and that's wonderful. There are many aspects of your ministry, many things that make this church what it is, and there are many things that make Oneida what it is. And so one of those parts of our ministry is that we do not tell that young person who has been a dropout. And we know that in Eastern Kentucky, many young people, for various reasons, do drop out. And then after a year or two in the real world, they begin to learn that, listen, I need my education. I cannot get a full-time job. I cannot make but anything but minimum wage. I don't get any paid holidays. I don't get a vacation. I don't get any hospital benefits. And I realize that until I get my education, I'm never going to be able to do anything in the work world. And so now when they're 19 or 20 or 21, sometimes as old as 22, and they come knocking on our doors and they say, Mr. Underwood, I'm sorry, you know, 3 years ago, 4 years ago, when I thought I knew so much and I couldn't wait to get out in the real world to get a real job and make real money, but I had no concept of reality, and now I want to come back and get my education. Many Christian schools will turn those young people away because they have in their admissions policy that a young person who's 19 or over, or sometimes over 19, they won't take them. And they can give you all kinds of reasons for it. But again, as I go and I search the scriptures in Luke, the 15th chapter, another parable that Jesus tells, again, one that you know, Jesus said there was a man who had two sons. The younger of those sons came to his dad one day and said, Dad, how about you giving me my portion of the inheritance? I think it's rather amazing that in exactly one verse, the son asks for the money and dad gives it to him. It doesn't surprise any of us that the next verse says, and not many days thereafter, he took what little bit he wanted to. He had his little bag of gold there and he headed into a far country. He was going to travel. Well, you know what happened when his money ran out, when reality set in, when a famine came along and he found himself out in the pig pen. Hungry as a pig, dirty as a pig, smelled like a pig, and looked like a pig. He said, this is ridiculous. My father has servants who eat well and sleep in clean beds, and here I am out in the pig lot. Now, at Oneida, we know about pigs. We smell pigs every day. The fragrance comes across the valley there all the time. We know what it's like to be out where the pigs are and have that kind of smell. But you know, two wonderful things happen in this parable. The first thing is that Jesus says that when he was out there in a pig pen, one day he came to his senses. Now I know you know some people. I know some people that I wish would come to their senses. In-laws, neighbors, friends, people that you wish they would come to their senses. But I'll tell you what, there's another side to that story. Jesus says that when those people, when they come to their senses and you see them coming down the road of life, what you don't do is turn your back and walk the other way. You do what this father did and you run out and you hug them and you tell them you love them and welcome them home. And so Oneida, for many, many years, has not told that young person who, yes, made a terrible mistake a few years ago. We do not say, you've made your bed, you sleep in it, you had to have your way, you go your way. We welcome them back to Oneida, or if they've never been there, for the first time to come to Oneida, tell them they got to follow the same rules as everyone else. But we take those young people. A fourth thing that's unique about Oneida School is that we do not tell boys and girls that you have to be a model student academically to be a part of our school. It may surprise you, as it did me. I've learned a lot of things about being the president. Prior to Dr. Moore's death, my job on the campus was being the dean of boys in charge of our dormitory students, discipline and room assignments and caring for their needs, in charge of the student work program. I love both those jobs. But And I didn't seek this position that I had today. But in this position now, nearly 3 years, I've learned a lot about other schools that frankly overwhelmed me. I was very surprised in the summer of 95 when two families came to Oneida. One family came in June, one family came in July. They both had come from a very large Christian school, much larger than Oneida. They had over 1,000 students. It was a day school only, it wasn't a boarding school, but a very large Christian school. And the family that came in June told me the story. Said, "Mr. Underwood, we're upset with our school. We received a letter this month from the administrator of our school. And it said," and it named their son and said, "your son is," and I quote, "no longer a proper Christian role model," unquote. "Mr. Underwood," they say, "that my son is no longer a proper Christian role model because his GPA, his grade point average, dropped below a 2.0. And so they've given us two or three options. One is withdraw our child because he isn't a good Christian role model, because his GPA is 2.0, and that was the only problem. That wasn't an excuse to get rid of him. That was his only problem. Or we can tutor our child and help him bring his grades up. They're going to put him on probation for 6 weeks when school resumes in August. Or they offered to provide a tutor for us for $500 additional. And that if my son could make the progress in 6 weeks, that he could then be in good standing with the school. And so the family that came in June said, "We're just a little disturbed that our school put this kind of restrictions on our child by saying he's not a proper Christian role model." Well, the family came in July, and from the same school, and it was another young man, and gave me almost verbatim the same story, except they said that the tutor would cost $400. Well, one of those students enrolled at Oneida, and the other student did not. And the last year, this young man whose GPA dropped below a 2.0 was not therefore a good Christian role model in his school. The last time I checked his grades at Oneida last year, it was 3.1. He had a 3.1 GPA. And you say, "Well, that's wonderful," but no, that's not wonderful, because in my opinion, both of those boys could have made 2.0s in their school back home. They had the mental capacity to reach that goal. But we have one entire building set aside on our campus called our special help building, Sanderson Hall. And it is there for the sole purpose of working with boys and girls who are weak academically. Oh, they may someday make the 2.0 grade point average, but they'll probably never, more than likely never, be A and B students. They're probably not college bound. They're simple boys and girls who are terribly behind academically, and we provide one teacher or teacher's aide on average for every two students because they have to have that intensive tutoring. They cannot focus on a lesson, and we help those boys day in and day out in their reading and math skills.